Through this door to my right, your left. and just follow that around the right. There's a men's room. Keep going around to the hallway. You'll find a women's room opposite the men's room down that hall. Even if you are a long time part of the church family, there have been renovations, perhaps since you were here last, and those restrooms have moved. There's also a family restroom around here to the right. And they all have changed their themes. I invite you, now that you finally got seated and comfortable, to locate the hymnal on the rack in front of you and stand as we sing together, "His Eye is on the Sparrow," hymn number 103.
Thank you.
invite you to be seated. There are times that I feel a bit of a fraud. Because I can sing a song like His Eye Is on the Sparrow. I sing because I'm happy, and I know in moments like this, it is hard to be happy. And there's a side of me, and perhaps a side of you, that has given way from song to sighing. But under it all, we know who watches us.
That's right.
We know who holds us close. I feel a bit of a fraud because I am not a singer. And typically, when it comes time to sing here at Scotch Plains Baptist Church, and by the way, I'm Chaz, I'm the pastor here. When it comes time to sing, I generally move as far from the microphone as I possibly can. Unfortunately, I moved that far and Patrick had to listen to me. And there's a side of me that says, I've got to mute myself so as not to be a disruption. But I think that would make me the bigger fraud. Because I think I need to sing that song. And I might not hit the right notes, and I have no clue what a key is.
It's all right.
But I can sing because I'm happy. Mm-hmm. Even in a moment like this. Even in a gathering like we're holding right now. We gather here today to give thanks for the life of Walter Lewis Wells Jr. He was born on March 28, 1975, and I had never realized before that he and my daughter shared a birthday. Mm-hmm. He shared his life with so many, and passed from this age into eternity, December 25th, 2023. It is in his memory that we gather, and for his life, a life well lived, that we are thankful. Join with me in our prayer of invocation. Holy God, eternal Spirit, before whom generations rise and pass away, join us here in this time of somber reflection and joyous remembrance. By your Spirit, speak peace to our spirits. O Holy One, we find that even in the face of death, our words can be those of thanksgiving. We're thankful for one who shared his life among us and with us, for whom friends and family provided such joy, and for whom he reciprocated that joy. For one who built with strength and who shared his strength with all. For the joy of living, for the struggles of life, for the triumph of character over trial, of strength over difficulty, of courage over sorrow, we give thanks.
Yes.
And now, O Lord, grant us such strength in the memory of this our loved one that we may be thankful for the gift of life that was given to each of us. And in our hearts, may the loss of Walter be balanced by thanksgiving for life shared with so many. In the name of our Lord, amen.
Amen.
We'll have some readings from Scripture this morning.
They know how to shine light in the darkness and explore the farthest regions of the earth as they search in the dark for ore. They sink a mine shaft into the earth far from where anyone lives. They descend on ropes swinging back and forth. Food is grown on the earth above, but down below, the earth is melted as by fire. Here the rocks contain precious lapis lazuli, and the dust contains gold. These are treasures no bird of prey can see, no falcon's eye observe. No wild animal has walked upon these treasures. No lion has ever set his paw there. People know how to tear apart flinty rocks and overturn the roots of mountains. They cut tunnels in the rocks and uncover precious stones. They dam up the trickling streams and bring to light the hidden treasures that do people know, but do people know where to find wisdom? Where can they find understanding? No one knows where to find it, for it is not found amongst the living. It is not here, says the ocean, nor is it here, says the sea. It cannot be bought with gold. It cannot be purchased with silver. It's worth more than all the gold of Ophir, greater than precious onyx and lapis lazuli. Wisdom is more valuable than gold and crystal. It cannot be purchased with jewels mounted in fine gold. Coral and jasper are worthless in trying to get it. The price of wisdom is far above rubies. Precious peridot from Ethiopia cannot be exchanged for it. It's worth more than the purest gold, but do people know where to find wisdom? Where can they find understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of all humanity. Even the sharp-eyed birds in the sky cannot discover it. Destruction and death say, we've heard only rumors of where wisdom can be found. God alone understands the way to wisdom. He knows where it can be found, for he looks throughout the whole earth and sees everything under the heavens. He decided how hard the winds should blow and how much rain should fall. He made the laws for the rain and laid out a path for the lightning. Then he saw wisdom and evaluated it. He set it in place and examined it thoroughly. And this is what he says to all humanity. The fear of the Lord is true wisdom. To forsake evil is real understanding.
Be with him, please. The Lord remember his wife. Thank you for loving. Guide her in the way that she needs to go, Lord, in many days that she don't hear his voice. Or even, Lord, to know that, Lord, you're God beside your heavens and above. And I come to say thank you, because you've been so good and you've been so kind, Father. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves, Lord. So as we gather today, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you bless all of us here today. And thank you for the time that we had with Walter Jr. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
In just a moment, we're going to sing together again. And again, I'm going to move from the microphone, and I'm going to go over to that area where Walter's mom sat for Sunday after Sunday, singing in the choir.
Amen.
And I can kind of picture her face hearing me sitting next to her sing, but I'm not a prod, so I'm going to sing it. And we're going to sing hymn number 554, and I'm singing hymnal in front of you. It is well with my soul. And when I sing, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It's well with my soul. I encourage you to stand as we sing together. Hymn number 554, it is well with my soul.
Thank you.
few remarks. We got a box of them. We'll do a few. We offer our deepest sympathy, IUOE Local 25. With deepest sympathy from Natasha, your co-workers, and Marcus SNLR. Our thoughts are with you. May the warmth of family, friends, and wonderful memories try to comfort you at this difficult time from all the SJE community. I'm going to say a quick remark now that I'm about to move into. I have an older sister, Natasha, and I have an older brother, Walter. For my niece and nephew, Big Wall.
Mm-hmm.
Bart. We all know him by many different names, but he's still the same person.
Well,
a gentle giant.
That's right.
Walter loved family, he loved people, and most of all, he loved to be happy. We will miss him, but we will not forget him. Walter, I'm his youngest brother. He became my oldest brother when I was 8 years old. Loved family. Always looked out for everybody. And the funniest guy in the world. We don't miss him. Love you all. Thank you.
Praise be to God. Nicholas was day one, and Shelley was filled with fun. He often shared funny stories about his siblings, and the love he had for them was effortless. Walter graduated from Scotch Plains Family High School in 1993. There he played football and developed many lasting friendships. After graduation, Walter attended the Seafarers Harry Lumberg School of Seamanship and became a merchant marine in 1995. Walter's merchant marine career began in Japan on the LNG LIO oil ship. Walter's work ethic was instilled in him as a child as he watched his father provide and protect the family. Walter would often say, "You can call me Little Walt, but I'm Big Walt." Big Walt had two meanings, his size, but most importantly, he saw his father as a big man. He wanted to be just like him. With the support from his dad in 1997, Walter joined the New York Carpenters Union, Local 1556, formerly 1456, where he worked passionately as a proud dock builder. Walter took dock building very seriously. He understood the importance of working safely, as his commitment to his union brothers was known throughout the union. He had a deep respect for the old timers. Recently, he realized, though, that he was an old timer. Walter married his high school friend, Latasha, in 1997, and they have two amazing children, Brianna and Nico. That's still up for grabs. Walter, his pride and joy was his family. He was the definition of provide and protect. Look in the dictionary, Walter's name is there. Walter would remind his family every opportunity he could that his job was to make sure they were good and didn't need anything. Brianna was his baby girl. Nico made him feel proud. And Latasha was the one that Walter would often say, T holds me down. Walter had a special bond with his cousins, Ricky, Rory, Ryan, Omar, Rashad, T-Roy, Darnell, Buzzy. He said they were more like brothers. His friends, Paul, Dwayne, Mark, Khalil, his work friends from Local 1556. In my Walter's voice, you already know. Walter was so proud to be a Wells, and any and everyone that was a part of the family and connected to the family, Walter showed love and protected them. Walter knew how to make people laugh. His laugh was contagious. Loud, too, may I add. And if you hung out with him, it was time for a turn up. Walter was a walking urban dictionary. Some of his favorite sayings were, keep it a buck, 100, you already know what it is, son, mate, what's up, ma, say less. If you spoke to Walter, you heard these words, and we're in church, and you may want. Walter was a man's man. His word was his bond. Walter was preceded in death by his mother, Patricia Wells, his sister, Michelle Fountain, his paternal and maternal grandparents, George and Norma Wells, and David and Beverly Barker, Aunt Judy Wells, and his father-in-law, Renzo Neal and Daniel. Mr. Walter Lewis Wells Jr. leaves behind his family and friends to carry his legacy. He's survived by his wife, Latasha Wells, his son, Nico Wells, his daughter, Brianna Wells, his father, Walter and Nettie Lewis Wells Sr., his brothers, Corey and Renee Wells, Nicholas Xavier Wells, Aunt Tony Harris, Aunt Gigi Whitney, Lois Wells, his mother-in-law, Darlene McDaniel, brother-in-laws, Lorraine and Sue McDaniel, Lamar and Rachel McDaniel, Najee and Aja McDaniel, host of nieces and nephews, Zaire Brooks, Deshaun Brooks, Lanesha McDaniel, Ozzy Thomas, Joseph Monroe, Lauren McDaniel, Kaya Simone Gibson Brooks, Jaden Brooks, Amber McDaniel, Najee Lulaj McDaniel, Mason McDaniel, Logan McDaniel, Lorraine McDaniel, and Nasir McDaniel. So many and a host of family and a multitude of friends who will forever cherish his memory. When I thought about Walter this morning, I said, well, you did it again. Here you go, you just don't listen. And thought about something he told me not long ago. He said, you know, in life, I have one regret. And he said his one regret was that he wanted to join the military. He said he wanted to be like his dad and his brother and his cousins that were in the military. And I looked at him and I said, but you're a soldier. Until today, I stand here and I think about the soldier that Walter was. And I just want to say, Walter, I salute you.
It's okay.
say anything I'm loving on his son, Nico. I just want to say thank you guys for welcoming him out. He really did love every single person in this room. You guys probably have a different story. I even remember him, but truthfully, we all gonna remember forever. He's a great guy. I can't think of one thing that me and my sister had to go out and close the game on our own. It was God already for us. He moved us out. He took care of us, man. I couldn't think of a better person, honestly. It was a hard relationship with all my dad. He's not no softy at all, anyway. But when it came to us, he had a soft heart, promise, truthfully, and he was protective. I thank all you guys for it.
He's the person who was very straightforward. If he was proud of you, he told you. If he was screwing up, he told you. There was no gray area with Walter. He always wanted everyone to be on the right track. He was a very, very strong individual who stood by his principles, whether you agree or not. I'm definitely going to miss chopping it up with him. You know how much he said he didn't like to talk, but he could talk. All of our talks were fun, also educational, because he had a lot of insight and a lot of interesting things to say. I'm going to end with love you, cuz. In that order. Say no more. He's back.
Big Homie, Big Walt, Little Walt, long time ago. And that's just to name a few. But my favorite is what I call Baby Brother. Walter was a presence that left a permanent mark on all of our lives. He was a gentle giant. His love knew no boundaries, and family for him went way beyond blood ties. If he loved you, you had no worries because Walt had your back, no questions asked. My brother was very persistent. No was not a part of his vocabulary. Telling him no only meant he needed to ask a little later or differently. And he achieved a yes almost every single time, because if it was you he was asking something for or of, you would just be tired of him asking and be like, okay. Besides being there when I needed him or an occasional I love you, my brother used to eat my food. For example, if I had a plate and I put it down at a cookout or put it in the fridge for later on, he would seek it out. And later I confront him like, why? You're gonna taste better. He was the baby whisperer. He could put any baby to sleep. His personality was top notch. Always kind, caring, and rough all at the same time. I was raised to be my brother's keeper. He was my baby brother. But as we became adults, things seemed to switch. And I went from taking care of him to him taking care of me and looking out for me. He is the reason I learned to drive a stick. And he taught me that being a Wells is more than just a last name. It is an attitude and a responsibility. Family, he believed, meant everything. Walter Lewis Wells Jr. was the greatest gift my parents ever gave me. His presence filled me with so much pride. He was definitely one of my most favorite people. My first best friend, a true ride or die. Today we say goodbye, for now, to this amazing man. Remember him with gratitude for the joy, laughter, shenanigans, and love he brought to our lives. May his memory live on in our hearts, and may we carry forward the lessons he taught us about the meaning of family and love. Dad, I love you. That's all I'm gonna say, because you don't like a fuss. Corey, I see matching tattoos on our future in honor of Walt. Tasha, Bree, Nico, I have no words that can help, but I promise you, I will be present. And as your mom said, you can take that to the bank. So everyone, be like Walt and love women in peace, always. That's it, that's all. In closing, I'd like to recite part of a poem called A Wish and a Prayer. I will wear your memory proudly, my brother, my true friend. May my love for you reach heaven above until we meet again. Rest in peace.
You may have noticed in the order of service that this a time for tributes. I've looked at the size of the room. I've looked at my time. We're going to have some tributes. We're probably not going to get every one of you. I would ask that you try to keep it brief. And to save time, I'd encourage you to stand where you are, not come up here with this microphone, which means you're going to have to project a little bit. And share a brief tribute. Is there someone who would like to go first? Break the ice. I didn't scare you all off, did I? It's all right. Yes. Anyone else? Nice and loud so that the microphones pick up for those who are seeing us on stream.
Without seeing the other, took all three of them together, and my prayers go out to you guys. one memory. Tasha and Walter hosted Thanksgiving a few years back. A lot has transpired since then, but the one thing that I can say is that that day, we were family. And as poised and quiet as Walter is, he held me down, he was solid. Tasha, we love you, your family, and you and together.
I know that there's a lot more stories to tell. I'm guessing if you're here, you have at least one, if not dozens, to share. I'm going to encourage you to remember those stories. Share them with friends, share them with family. Pick up the phone, make a call. Write an old-fashioned card, an old-fashioned handwritten story. Pass that on. The stories don't stop just because we've run out of time for the moment. Thank you for those stories. Continue to share them.
Let us pray. Lord, we ask today that you bring these open lips of mine. And all the time I ask you, Lord, to set me down because I'm not worthy. I'm a sinner only saved by the grace and mercy of God. But I find myself, Lord, leaning and depending on you. Mother has gone. Father has gone. And nobody but you, God, can keep me today. And know my heart, you know my mind. But thank you that you allow me to come today, Lord, to come to this family. And to let them know that there's a God, he lives, and he lives within our souls. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This is a difficult time for me. And I give honor and glory to the Almighty God and to his darling Son Jesus. And to Pastor Ted, thank you again. He greeted me. I went back to look for him. To his Marie family, I've been known a long, long time. Amen. Now, one thing I don't like is a quiet church.
Amen.
I'm an old Baptist preacher from New Orleans. If you don't know me, I worked at Walter Wells Senior a long time. And working for him is tough. Because he didn't pay me. He taught me a lot. And I come today to share with you not only just about Walter, but I come to share the word of God with you. Amen?
Amen.
It's something about trying to explain somebody else's eulogy that only his wife and his children know. Amen? So when I die, I want my wife to do my eulogy because she knows me. So there's a word today, and I never say how long I'm going to be, because I don't know what the Spirit of the Lord is going to do. Amen?
Yeah.
And Chad put a time on it, but he can't put a time on God's word. Yeah. Amen?
Yeah.
For you Bible readers and those who are here today, I want you to write this down. From the Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 6th chapter. It's the first gospel in the New Testament, and it's written by Matthew. And I will commence reading. And I don't know why I get so nervous, but the Lord can help me out today. I need you to pray for me and to pray with me. The 6th chapter of Matthew and the 25th verse. Therefore I say unto you, take not thought for your life, what you shall eat, or what you shall drink. Know ye your body, what you shall put on, is not your life more than meat, and the body more than raiment. Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither reap, nor gather no more, yet the heavenly Father feed them. Or you not much more than thee? May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of the word. I thought for today is for all of you here today because you need to know. You ought to say, it is the Lord's will. Amen? We should practice this in our lives because no matter how our lives may go, it's going to be the Lord's will. Now, if you don't say nothing, tell how long I got. Amen.
Remember that congregation.
Walter Wells Jr. grew up under his father and I. They see a giant. He used to call me Pops. And I saw him when he was this little. And I see him, he got this big. But I respect him. If you look at the pictures in the back, I'm the short man that married them, and I had some hair on my head. And today we come just not only to talk about him, because all of you here today, doctors, I thank you, all of you, for coming today, all of you here today. Tasha used to see that. They loved him. They loved him. But in every person, they are so wrong. You understand me in that? I know I do some wrong, but I have a God that lives in my soul. I married him, and I look back, and I start to cry. Because memories will bring a lot in your life when you look back. Your daughter and your son, I watched him grow. I think Nico used to be a baseball player, right? And he's grown now, and he got hair on his face. And he's taller than me. Lord has blessed you. Your father was a big giant. And I see it in there. He can take those fingers. He can put them in any kind of way. He wanted. The life that he lives should live in all of us that know him. The good and the bad. Amen?
How long was that,
Jack? I come to tell you today, Walter lives his life. My wife called me, and I was calling her. She said, sit down. I got something to tell you. Uh-oh. Did anybody call you from New Jersey? I got a son the same age as Walter. I sat down, and she told me a little more to pass. First thing I said, Lord, help me to understand a 48-year-old man passes away. You know what the Lord told me? You Bible readers? David had a son, and he laid down on the ground and was weeping for his son. And the servant came in and told him, your son is dead. He got up, the Bible says, put on new raiment, and went in to the house of God. And there was concern about him. And I come to tell his father, his wife, and his friends, he can't come back to us. But one thing about it, we can go to him. Oh, you ought to be shouting. The dead never comes back to the living, and the dead don't know what the living is doing. But all of us know what we are doing today. What is your life? If it's nothing but a mystery, a vapor that vanishes away, oh no, oh no, oh no. God knew that Walter was going to die the day that he conceived in his mother's womb. I'm telling you today, you should get your life in order to know where you're going. Oh, is it beautiful? I've seen people drink. I've seen people do a lot of things. And they got people here today who never saw me take a drink. But I'm not perfect. Amen? We have to look at life like this. Walter grew up and took care of his family. He was bold and big. I mean, whatever he had to say, you better listen. And his mother loved him. Lord, if she'd have been here today, woo! Let me tell you, she'll beat him down. Patty was a strong person, and I listened up to her. But now today, I look around. Walter was loved by all of you. And I thank all of you for coming, for this family, to share with them. In the deepest, deepest times like this, you need some love. You need somebody to tell you. And don't tell nobody you know how they feel. You don't know how I feel. You don't know if I wanted the person to die. You don't know what. Just tell them, I pray for you. There's a story that I've been looking at. And the little boy next door, the neighbor, he saw him crying. And the little boy was 4 years old. And seeing this, he clammed upon his neighbor's lap while he was crying. And he hugged him real tight. See, hug and tight to let you know that you love somebody means a whole lot. And then when he got down, his mother asked him, she said, "What did you tell him?" Listen what he said. "I just helped him cry." Today, you need to help her cry. Well, what do you mean? The Bible says we should laugh when somebody died in choice. And when somebody comes in the world, we should cry. We got so mixed up because we're flesh. Because when a baby come in this world, they come to sin. They got to face the same world that we live in and try to understand. But what is your life this morning? Well, preacher, I'll try to do my best. God don't make it in heaven. You've got to know Jesus for your Savior. You've got to live right. As much as you can to make it on home. You know what I'm trying to tell you? Tasha, thank you. Thank you. When she called me, it really got me down. And I was wondering, Lord, how I'm going to handle this. But the Lord will make a way somehow. Amen? And those of you who don't know me, my name is Pastor Patrick McDowell. I worked for weeks for a long time with Walter, senior engineer. And God has blessed me for my mighty long ways to be here today. Not to say farewell, but gone and not forgotten. He won't be forgotten. Mm-hmm. Those who sit in the midnight hour don't think about it. I lost a daughter, 39 years old, and I know how it feels within me. For Walter to lose his son. Walter, he was a big giant. Wasn't he, Walter? Oh, yes. But he respected his father. That's the main thing in life. You need to respect parents that's older than you, that can teach you something. I come in this world, it was 10 of us, and my father taught me how to work. And it can be proven that people that work with me, they got Mickey here today, other people here today that work with us, started out with us. And little Walter just came on. He used to tell me, "Pop, I know how to handle my job. I know what I'm doing." I like that. One thing about it, you get on the job, you learn everything. I used to tell people that you can't do my job alone in the company. But I can do yours. Ain't God good? Yes, God. Amen. Ain't God good? Yes. He's good all the time. I'm a Baptist preacher. And I love to have a good time. And I came here to let this family know we're going to have a good time. Because the Lord been good to us. He brought us from a mighty long way. Can I get a witness? He sees every step that we make. Can I get a witness? Sleep on, Walter, and take your rest. Yeah, we all coming home one by one. Can I get a witness? Yes, I know that he lived. He lived in my soul. Can I get a witness? Sleep. And take your rest. Don't worry about it. Every day, sunshine. But one day I'm going home. Can I get a witness? I'm going well. I'm going well. Jesus has been home and paid it all. I come to tell you this morning as I take my seat. Can I get a witness? Walter is gone on home. And we still here, and we need to praise God all our lives. Can I get a witness? Oh, Tasha, we thank you for the many days you had with him. Some good times,
some bad times. People may say something, but stand up tall like that big giant you was married to. Don't worry about him. He's resting in the arm of God. Thank all of you here today. And I pray to God I say something to help all of you here today. But one thing about it, Walter is his life. And what is your life? And where you going to spend it? Eternal life. Amen?
Amen.
Where you going to spend eternal life? But I made it up in my mind.
Yeah.
I'm going home.
Yeah.
I'm going with the walls. I made the jasper stones. And the streets are paved with gold.
Yeah.
And listen, in there, all of you old and feeble like me, they got a tree. For the nation.
Yeah.
And I ain't gonna be sick no more. I'm gonna see my father.
Yeah.
I'm gonna see my mother. And I'm gonna stand in the X-ray wall there. And the big old bag gonna sit back there. But most of all, I wanna see Jesus.
Yeah.
And I just wanna tell him, thank you. Thank you. That's what I wanna see.
Yeah.
But when he get there, mama gonna pat him and say, I've been waiting on you. My child is resting. Thank all of you for being here today. And I hope that everything you have done has been pleasing to your heart. Because it's tough to lose someone. But I tell my children, I got to leave here one day. And I can't stay here. Either there's a better place than this place. Oh, yes, Todd paying bills. Oh, yes. Can't, it's so rough now. Rent getting up. House note getting up. And you tell me there ain't a better place than this? Huh? Huh? I worked all my life with Big Walter and Big Walter. I lost my hair and I lost my life. And you tell me there ain't a better place than this? Rest on, Walter. Take your rest, man. Rest on.
Sleepless night.
sing now, I'd definitely be a frog.
Rabbi, it's home.
We are about the time to part for now. In just a moment, we'll have our benediction. And while it might be the end of our formal service together, our life celebration for Walter, it's not the end of relationship, and it's not the end of story.
That's right.
And again, I'll encourage you to pick up the phone, shoot a text, write a letter.
That's right. Amen.
Meet for coffee. Tell a story. Tell a story you've already told 10 times, the other person's already told it 10 times, because it's still worth telling. It's who we are. It tells us where we're coming from and where we're going. You'll have plenty of time to keep sharing those stories.
Yes.
When we conclude the service and the postlude is playing, I'm going to ask that you allow the family to remain seated, that you quietly take your leave, allow the family to have some time alone together here in the sanctuary. I know that you'd like to greet them one more time, or if you came in a little late, but please respect that time for the family. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking the time. And we recognize that there's some folks who physically couldn't be here, but they took the time to participate through the streaming of the service, and those that might, again, because of work schedules, etc., might be seeing this in a recording, their hearts and their spirits are going to join with you. They're going to join with the family. They're going to continue to tell the story. I'm going to ask you to stand and receive our benediction. Benediction as it comes from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and to an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you. Go now in the name of Jesus Christ. Be a blessing and be blessed. Amen.
Amen.